Hello and welcome to North Shore Fellowship's online service. We are glad that you have tuned in. Hey, if you're watching on Facebook, would you click the like and the share buttons? And if you're watching on YouTube, would you share the link directly with a friend? That is three ways where people can find out what is happening here at North Shore Fellowship's online service. Let's pray together and lean in to see what God has for us today. Father, we ask your blessings over this service. We ask that everyone listening and watching is able to feel your love. And we pray that everyone listening, watching, that we're able to receive what you have for us today. And I mean that you would open our ears to the teaching and our hearts to the worship and share with us this love that you have for your church. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Thank you.
Welcome, friends, to our series, Strength and Weakness, a study of 2 Corinthians. And last week we were in 2 Corinthians 3, and we're transitioning to 2 Corinthians 4. But let's double back to 3. Chapter 3 had some gems in it that I want to take in before we advance to chapter 4. And a couple of them are 2 Corinthians 3:17. And freedom is an essential component to our faith in God. And Paul explains there that neither people who live recklessly nor people who live completely under the legalistic weight of the law are free. Neither are free. The only freedom is through the Spirit who brings freedom. And then, as we all know, Jesus talked about freedom. In fact, in John 8, he says this thing twice. He says in John 8, 32, you will know the truth and the truth will set you free. And then in 36, so if the Son of Man sets you free, you will be free indeed. Do you understand? We're not free because we keep the law arduously and legalistically, nor are we free if we live recklessly and lawlessly. We find freedom in the life in the Spirit. And then he ends chapter 3 with these words. He says, even to this day, when Moses is read, a veil covers their hearts. But when anyone turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. And that means the covering. So he starts chapter 4 with the word therefore. And that's what it's predicated on, is this veil, this covering. So let's start chapter 4 of 2 Corinthians. And it says, therefore, since through God's mercy we have this ministry, we do not lose heart. Rather, we have renounced secret and shameful ways. We do not use deception, nor do we distort the word of God. On the contrary, by setting forth the truth plainly, we commend ourselves to everyone's conscience in the sight of God. And even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing. And Paul uses this phrase, those who are perishing, a lot. Those who are perishing are those who have no knowledge of the freedom that we find in the Spirit of God. They have no knowledge of the truth. They reject the gospel of Jesus Christ, and therefore they truly are perishing. Those are the ones that John talked about. You know, if God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son. Whoever believes in him will not be those who are perishing, will not perish, but have eternal life. And in their lostness, they are lost, they're blinded. See, they're lost and they're blinded to these things. In fact, when they are exposed to things of the Spirit, they don't find them helpful unless they're open to the things of the Spirit. In fact, if they just receive them and perceive them with their carnal mind, their natural mind, they find them detestable or even foolish. And that's why in the first book of Corinthians, first chapter, it says in verse 18, for the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing. But to those of us who are being saved, it is the power of God. You see, they're veiled in darkness and they cannot, quote unquote, see the light. And that's what Paul talks about in the very next verse, chapter verse 4. He says, the God of this age has blinded the minds of unbelievers so they cannot see the light of the gospel that displays the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. For what we preach is not of ourselves, but Jesus Christ as Lord, and ourselves as your servants for Jesus' sake. For God, who said, let light shine out of darkness, made his light shine in our hearts to give us the light of the knowledge of God's glory displayed in the face of Christ. Beautiful language. He's talking about, here's what we preach. What do we preach? We preach about the light of the knowledge of God's glory. You know, again, turning back to John. John, obviously, Paul was a student of John's gospel, or at least the same message through the same Spirit of God's, of John's gospel. In fact, John 1, 4, 9, 12, and 14, these verses say, in him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. Sound familiar? The true light, in verse 9, that gives light to everyone was coming into the world. Verse 12 says, to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. And in verse 14, the word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. And we have seen his glory, the glory of the one true Son. And again, that's why Paul is saying we have seen the glory of God displayed on the face of Christ. That was all made available as we are given the light and exposed to the light. And as it says, the light shines in our hearts, as we saw in verse 6. Beautiful language. Now, let's continue in verse 7. He says, but we have this treasure in jars of clay to show that this all-surpassing power is from God and not from us. We have the treasure in jars of clay. Treasure, something of great value, in jars of clay or earthen vessels, something that was very common, of common container. If you ever go to Israel, I've been there many times, oftentimes you'll visit an archaeological site, sometimes a new archaeological dig, something they just found and discovered, and they're digging. And most of the artifacts that they find many things, but the most common artifact that they find are something called pottery shards. Pottery shards, and they're just really bits and pieces of broken vessels, jars and cups, and things like that. And that's the most common thing. But in those, it gives clues, the era with which that jar would have been made and used. Sometimes even symbols and sometimes even writing on the little pieces and fragments of these jars. In fact, the oldest writing that we've found, Hebrew writing, was actually found on a piece of pottery, a pottery shard about 3,500 years old. Now, it's not always known what was in those jars, in those containers, but in most cases, these common clay vessels made out of clay, dried in the sun, contained something that was of exceedingly more value than the jar itself. Almost like, you know, a plastic water bottle or a paper cup or something, contains something that's very likely of more value than the container itself. Our bodies are that. Our bodies are those vessels, are those earthen vessels, those jars of clay. And what do we contain in our human bodies? Well, Paul tells us it's the temple of the Holy Spirit. Christ is in us, the hope of glory. You know, we contain, as we just read, the all-surpassing power of God. These vessels, these jars of clay that we have, are not judged just on the clay itself, on the earthen vessel itself, but we are valued because of what is in us, the all-surpassing power of God. And that should make you feel good about who you are, regardless of what your clay jar looks like lately. Let's go on to verse 8. It says, we are hard-pressed on every side, not crushed, perplexed, but not despaired, persecuted but not abandoned, struck down but not destroyed. We always carry around in our body the death of Jesus so that the life of Jesus may also be revealed in our body. I don't know about you, but I've myself, and I've seen several people, I know several people whose earthly body just is not what it used to be. And in some cases, people are very debilitated. Now, does that mean that their value has gone down? That the overall essence of who they are in Christ has just completely diminished? Absolutely not. In many cases, as the body decays, as the body wears down, the spirit rises up. And in many cases, these seasoned brothers and sisters have more value in their wisdom and knowledge and experience of the true Holy Spirit within them than they may have when they were young and strong and, you know, in worldly terms, more able. But we experience these things that we just talked about, being hard-pressed, not crushed, perplexed, not despaired, persecuted, not abandoned, struck down, not destroyed. And this is what is known as the fellowship of the sufferings of Christ, or his suffering. You know, he was all these things, yet he did not despair. He was not abandoned. He was not destroyed. Philippians 3:10 says, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings. We have fellowship with Jesus, who suffered like this and more. Hard-pressed, perplexed, persecuted, struck down. But that's okay, because the life within us is something of great value. It was what Paul just called the all-surpassing power of God. You have in you, your vessel, the all-surpassing power of God. He explains this more clearly as the chapter ends. And the chapter ends here. I mean, it doesn't get more rich than that. Fixing our eyes, focusing our eyes, being fixated not on what is seen, but what is unseen. The glory of God, which is unseen. What's seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. And to understand what it is, to fix our eyes on that which is unseen, requires the basic element of our purpose and our relationship with God, faith. Faith. Pistis, trust, faith. Faith in God. How could we see what is unseen? By faith. You see, believing in God, trusting in God, requires us to put our faith in that which our human eyes and natural perception just cannot perceive. That's what's the difference between a natural man and a spiritual man. If we have faith, we can trust in God. We can live in the Spirit, and we can see the things that our natural eyes are blinded to. The author of Hebrews defines faith in this way. Hebrews 11:1. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen, things unseen, evidence. You know, some would say, skeptics, and you almost can't blame them. Listen, I'm not going to be convinced unless I have substance that I can verify, that I can really research, that I can look at, that I can explore and examine and verify. If you don't give me that substance, I can't believe. And then also evidence. You have evidence? Let me see it. You got some evidence? Show it to me, and maybe you can convince me. I want to tell you something. That approach is the opposite of faith. That is doubt. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, evidence of things not seen. Is that you? Do you ever find yourself doubting God because he doesn't present to you the scientific evidence that your mind craves, and so that you can convince your skeptical mind that he's real and his word is true? Give me that evidence. You know, the apostles were like this. And Jesus was gracious to them. He had just risen from the dead. Some had seen him, went back and told the rest, "We saw him alive." They didn't believe. They was hanging out in that house where he approached eventually, didn't believe. They were just doubtful. In fact, he was so disappointed in their unbelief that when he finally did appear to them, he rebuked them for it. You know, this is particularly true of Thomas, who was called the Doubting Thomas, because he didn't believe. And we'll just read this in John 20, 24 through 27. Now Thomas, also known as Didymus, also known as Didymus, Diddy means twin, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my finger where his nails were and put my hand in his side, I will not believe." Well, 26, a week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. And though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." And then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. See my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Stop doubting and believe." Stop doubting and believe. That simple. You know, he gave Thomas the practical physical evidence, but he did it to show that Thomas is a doubter. And then he said, "Believe." And I truly believe Thomas must have believed. See, when we fix our eyes on Jesus, it means we're opening the eyes of our heart, as Paul says, and allowing his truth as revealed in our spirit to be an indicator of what's true and what's not true, what's real and what's not real. You know, you watch the news, you hear stories, you see things online. How do you know what's true? How do you know what's not true? There's a lot of misinformation, disinformation. There's a lot of calculated deception coming from mainstream media sources that are designed to deceive you. How do you know what's true and what's not true? I believe the Spirit within us is an indicator. Jesus says the Spirit will lead you into all truth. He will show us. If we open the eyes of our heart, may not have every answer, but we'll have a general idea of where the deception sources are coming from. And that's why Paul prayed for the Ephesians in Ephesians 1:18. "I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order that you may know the hope to which he has called you." Boom, like open the eyes of your heart. See, our world is, whether you know it or not, is under the influence of the great deceiver. That's the devil. And Jesus calls him the father of lies. Revelation 12 says he deceives the whole world. That's what he does. He deceives. And our battle is not against the people and the ideologies that we're so mad at, political parties that we don't like, dictators, even military regimes. Our battle's not against them. Our battle is against those whom the deceiver has put in power to influence and to deceive us. And they're called heavenly realms, forces of evil in heavenly realms. Again, Ephesians 6, chapter 6, verse 12. Our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, against the spiritual forces of evil in heavenly realms. That means they're unseen. Those heavenly realms are not the earthly realms. These heavenly realms are the unseen places. They're invisible to us in the natural, even though their destruction and their devastation is very apparent on earth. You just see the carnage of what evil has done to the earth. But the realms themselves are unseen, they're invisible. And that's why there's so much evil and hatred and darkness and dissonance and bitterness, hopelessness, despair, depression in the world. You see how dark it is. And these are clear results of the works of the deceiver. Now, if and when we approach this and rely on what we can see in our carnal mind and our human ability, well, the world remains hopeless and dark. But when we fix our eyes on Jesus and view things by faith and see things how he sees things, that's when we walk in hope and victory and courage and strength. And we know his word is true. 1 John 4:4, he who is in you is greater than he that is in the world. One of my favorite examples of this in scripture is something that took place in 2 Kings. And the king of Aram, which is an enemy of Israel, was pursuing the armies of Israel to destroy them. But he was frustrated because every time he planned a secret attack, it just seems the Israelites knew it and were able to, you know, to outrun him or escape or whatever it might be. He just couldn't get them because his secret attacks were always exposed. And then he was told that Elisha, the prophet of Israel, would tell him, would supernaturally discover the plan and tell him. And so that's why, you know, the king of Israel was always outwitting the king of Aram. Now, this enraged the king of Aram, and he set his sights on chasing down not Israel's armies. Now he just wants to get Elisha out of the way. So he's chasing down Elisha, the prophet. And 2 Kings 6, 13 through 18 says this, king of Aram, go find out where he is, the king ordered, so I can send men and capture him. The report came back, he's in Dothan. And then he sent horses and chariots and a strong force there. They went by night and surrounded the city. Now they're surrounding the city. When the servant of the man of God, Elisha, got up and went out early the next morning, an army with horses and chariots had surrounded the city. Oh no, my Lord, what shall we do? The servant asked. All right, just pause right there. Elisha's servant, traveling with him, gets up in the morning. I don't know what he's going to do. Stoke the fire, cook some breakfast. But there was a massive army of chariots and horses, enemy armies surrounding them. Oh no, my Lord, what shall we do? The servant asked. Then Elisha shows up. He says, don't be afraid. Those who are with us are more than those who are with them. And then Elisha prayed for him. Open his eyes, Lord, so that he may see. And then the Lord opened the servant's eyes, and he looked, and he saw the hills full of horses and chariots of fire all around Elisha. These are the chariots of fire of the Lord, the greater army surrounding them and protecting them. And as the enemy came down toward them, Elisha prayed to the Lord, strike this army with blindness. So he struck them with blindness, as Elisha had asked. The chariots of the Lord protecting them, the armies of Aram coming against them, and the armies of Aram, the enemy armies, struck with blindness. Now, Elisha's servant, he went from seeing through the eyes of the natural, seeing what was seen, to seeing what was unseen. Just like that, Elisha prayed for him, and the eyes of his heart, spirit, were opened up, and he saw. You know, it's amazing when we see things as God sees them, the reality. There is angelic warfare going on all the time, not just back there in 2 Kings, but here in this time that we live in as well. And isn't it amazing that the servant's eyes were opened, but the enemy army eyes were blinded? And that's so much what it's like. It's so similar what is happening in this world. As we pray, as we seek the Lord, we're given spiritual sight. And we can see things that the world can't see. Whether we sense it, whether we just know it in our spirit, whatever it might be, we are aware of things that the world is unawareness, and we have sight, and the world stumbles in blindness. 1 Corinthians 2:14, the natural man does not receive the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness to him, nor can he know them because they're spiritually discerned. Well, let's close with, let's go back to those verses that I liked so much in verse 17 and 18 of chapter 4 here in our chapter. For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but what is unseen, since what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. And many of us have our eyes fixed on what is seen. We're just focused on the things of the world, and we see the trouble in the world, see the trouble in our own life. And you try to look for solutions in this world and solutions in this life, and those solutions can only come from God, so we end up disappointed. But if we're able to walk by faith, and it takes faith to believe what you can't physically see, to trust in God and allow His Spirit to open your spiritual eyes, you'll find something really beautiful. You'll find that you're aware that He is your protector. He is your provider. He is the one who's already carried you through some of the most troubling times in your life. And He is the one that's watching over you. Yeah. You have this assurance that the Lord is watching over you. And some of us need to ask the Lord to literally fix our eyes, not fixate our eyes, but repair our eyes from just looking at the natural to be able to operate and look into the spiritual, to fix them so that we're not only looking at what is seen, but we're able to look at what is unseen. So we're able to fix our eyes on Jesus because His eyes are fixed on us as He watches over us. We'll end with Psalm 121, and it says this: I lift my eyes to the mountains. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. He will not let your foot slip. He who watches over you will not slumber. Indeed, he who watches over Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord watches over you. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun will not harm you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from harm. He will watch over your life. The Lord will watch over your coming and going, both now and forevermore. That's my encouragement to you, is to allow God to watch over you and to be aware of Him and to ask Him to fix your eyes, to open the eyes of your heart, and that you would fix your eyes on Jesus. He's the author. He's the finisher. He's the perfecter of your faith. God bless you.
Eternity in your hands. You speak. spoke the earth into motion, my soul now to stand. You stood before my failures, you carried the cross for my shame. My sin weighed upon your shoulders, my soul now to stand. What can I say?
Thanks for being with us at North Shore Fellowship Online. My heart and my prayer is that the Lord spoke to you through His Word. And if that's true, please reach out to me and let me know how, and let me know how I could pray for you. And if you've come to a point where you're ready to make a full-on lifetime commitment to Jesus, one that you've never made before, well, I'd be honored and thrilled to talk to you about it and to lead you into a prayer of salvation. Just reach out. Until then, hey, make yourself available to the many things that we have going on as we enter the holiday season and the new season to come. Don't be a stranger. We look forward to seeing you every week, and hopefully you'll connect live with us sometime as well. God bless you.